Pharmacovigilance in Kenya has grown quite a bit from what it used to be. It initially was a department, we used to say a desk run by two people who would basically encourage health care providers to generate reports, to report even just about adverse drug reactions, quality issues to do with medicines. But now it has grown. It is a directorate in the country with various subdivisions, with the staff numbers have also increased. I think it should be almost 20. And each the roles have divided, they've subdivided several roles. So you have medicine information, you have clinical trials, you have post-market surveillance. So pharmacovigilance has grown in Kenya. And now even while looking beyond just the regulator, is looking at how the practice can grow within health facility level. So that is where we are at. And even working with academia to see how to encourage, to boost the training, build the capacity of other pharmacists and healthcare providers in the practice of pharmacovigilance. Well, there are quite a few challenges in pharmacovigilance. When you think of the word report, usually report has a negative connotation. So sometimes people, when they think they are going to report something, they think that something punitive will come. But to just change that mindset. So the challenge is having to change that mindset that reporting is a good thing. Reporting is going to help save lives, and reporting helps you to gather data that will make a difference in that health facility. So it is not something to make others look bad. And reporting also helps to change practice, because when you realize that a certain medication is causing harm to the population, or they're having adverse effects that are going to make them have lose confidence in the healthcare system. And we want public confidence in the healthcare system, particularly the public healthcare system. So that's why we want to encourage reporting, so that even the patients know we are watching out. Even as they come for healthcare, something can go wrong, but it is not the fault. It's not a fault of a practitioner, because we don't have enough studies about how the medicine will work in our population. Reporting helps us to know how does that medicine work in our population. We have had to think of different strategies to communicate or to encourage healthcare providers to report, because we have standard tools that are designed by the regulator for reporting. But you find that in the routine work of healthcare providers, you'll find they're too busy. So you have to think of creative ways to get them to report. Whether it is you use a lot of the social media forum, WhatsApp, we have several groups, or even health facilities have WhatsApp forums. So if you can just tell them, okay, maybe you would not have time to fill in all the details, but just give us a snapshot of what it is you have encountered in your practice, and then somebody will come, like the focal person, to dig up all the information, fill what is required for it to go to the board. So at least when, in my health facility, there's a lot of use of people taking the photos, posting it on the pharmacy group, and now that keeps us on alert, those of us who are there in pharmacovigilance field, that, okay, now we've noticed there's such a problem, we can institute an action to sort it out within the health facility. Say sometimes they report medicines that look alike. So now everybody knows, okay, there are a number of medicines that we have currently in our facility that look alike. There can be confusion. So they alert their fellow colleagues. The news spreads faster than if we were to send out a circular. So sometimes people say, if you want to hide something from people, put it in a book. So sometimes putting something in a circular rarely, or a newsletter, might not really get the attention of somebody unless they have that interest in reading. But we find if you use a forum that is easy, people will be constantly checking their phone or maybe on Facebook. So some alerts, you can post it on a Facebook forum and it spreads much faster than if we were to try and communicate with our dear doctor letter. We encourage patients to report adverse drug reactions, or even quality issues, or even medication errors that they may experience in the course of accessing healthcare, whether it is at our health facility itself or from other, if they have sought health care in other, among other service providers. So we encourage them to report. Currently, there's a drive to work on a tool to make a patient a reporting tool that is easy for patients to use, possibly a mobile application, because we say in Kenya, the access to mobile phone is the best. Literally everyone has a mobile phone. They may not have a bank account and other things, but they will have a mobile phone. So if we have a mobile app that allows a patient to report, then they don't have to fear or to rely on the doctor to relay the report to the health facility. Sometimes they might be coming for the appointment, the queue is long, and by the time they get to see the doctor, they have forgotten that they had an issue with the medicine. But when you have that app, it is easy. If they have an issue with the medicine, it makes report more timely. But we also, during the process of medication use counseling, encourage the pharmacy staff or pharmacy practitioner dispensing to just ask a basic question, any issue with your medicine, so that now the patient can be triggered to say, okay, the last time I took a certain inhaler, I didn't feel any better. Or when they see a certain product, then they say, but at the last time this happened, I did not. Then we encourage them to say a little bit more about that product, as opposed to before there was a culture that probably the doctor is king and you can't question any decision. So we are trying to change that perception in the patients. And we are getting quite a number of patients coming and reporting, you know, the last time I took this medicine, this happened. And we encourage the staff to document that. And then now we can even look at what more details could be missing about the patient. Is it an issue of the quality of the medicine, or is it the patient and actually the medicine that would, the adverse drug reaction or event is related to actually the medicine and not a quality issue? I think Kenyan pharmacovigilance practice is possibly different from other countries, because when we think about reporting, we have public health programs that have seen a difference that has come because of reporting. When we have, and then we also have patients who are, or the consumers, say in general, the population, who are more sensitive about the medicine use. So when you want to roll out any public health program or just some intervention in an area, you need to start thinking, how will you deal with the safety and quality issues? So in that case, that has raised the profile of the pharmacovigilance directorate within the country, because now people are more keen about a medicine. They're keen to shout when they think there's something wrong. We've had quite a number of, a few incidences of complaints with the vaccines. And you know, we need the vaccines because it's basically, nobody is sick at the point they're getting a vaccine. So they would probably want to, why should I experience any pain or possible adverse effect? And I don't feel sick now. But we know we need the vaccines to prevent more people from being sick from a viral infection that can clear populations in a short while. So the reporting among, because when the population knows if there's a problem, I can actually safely sound an alert, and something will be done about it. The thought that the Pharmacy and Poisons Board will actually do something about it has helped to encourage that reporting culture. And I think that, I don't know how too well how in other countries it works, but it helps the public confidence when they know they will say something and there will be a response. Well, Kenya joined the WHO International Drug Monitoring Program in 2010 as a full member. And well, the structure of pharmacovigilance in the country, if I could just give an overview, there's a national regulatory authority, the Pharmacy and Poisons Board of Kenya. And it's within the Pharmacy and Poisons Board that the Pharmacovigilance Directorate is housed and it runs its activities. It's under the regulator. So I'd mentioned earlier that it began basically as a two-person unit, and it has grown in terms of the staffing and even the subdivision of work, the various roles that the team are engaged in. And then from the national level, they work with the focal persons within hospitals. We were fortunate enough in Kenya, our program, a master's program in pharmacovigilance and pharmacoepidemiology was started. So there are quite a number of pharmacy practitioners within spread around the country who have that training, and they are good source, they are good link persons for people to be able to ensure that the activities of the board actually get down to the ground. And the focal persons are spread all over in health facilities, in public health programs. And so there's somebody who's actually very keen to get information and relay that to the board and make sure that communication goes back to their either health facility or public health program, so that now you can sustain. And the training also, there's plans underway to have it as an online training to allow even more pharmacists to be able to take up the course, because taking time off to study can be a challenge. So when it is offered as a blended course, it is possible then for more to get enrolled and take part in the course, so that even as you're practicing with a lot more knowledge than what you would get in a sensitization exercise. So the board working together even with the focal persons and the health facilities do sensitizations within health facilities, within programs on pharmacovigilance. What is pharmacovigilance? The scope it covers, how to report, and the feedback channels, how do they get feedback and relay feedback to the same. So there are a whole range of training exercises can be conducted depending on how much time. So it could be probably a one-day sensitization to a department. So for like myself, as I work in a hospital institution, you can, during either a workshop, you can have a slot where you let the healthcare professionals know that, you know, we have a system. If there's a quality issue with a medicine, or if a patient experiences a medication error or an adverse drug reaction following treatment, then now there's a way to report. And the reporting is not so that it can be punitive or used in a negative manner, but the report is so that we can make a positive change. The report is to promote patient safety. And when it comes to medication, when people report a certain adverse drug reaction, sometimes we realize the problem is not the quality of the medicine, but the form. So we recently realized whether having an L isomer and D isomer will actually decide whether or not you're going to have an adverse drug reaction. So we notice those changes. We communicate to our medicine and therapeutics committee. We also communicate to our supplies department, our procurement department, our tender evaluation team, so that now, in going forward, we can be on the watch what products give us an issue if it's quality related, and if we realize that there are some certain products which you're likely to have adverse effects or medication errors related to them, so what can we do about it? So recently, because of confusion of medicines that look alike or sound alike, we started rolled out the use of labels, the look-alike, sound-alike labels, and even just products could require cold chain, and somebody might not be familiar with that product. So now the labeling. So we're really working on labeling to make sure that someone knows this is a cytotoxic medicine. There's a certain way you should handle it. In case it spills, don't just wipe it off like any other medicine. This medicine looks like or sounds like another. So when you're dispensing it, just confirm. Say it's good to perform a triangle check. Check what is on the prescription, check what it is you have, and then you counter check again. If you can't have someone double check, just check yourself again. What is on the prescription? What have I given? And is that really what the patient had wanted, was expecting to get, so that you can be sure? Sometimes the patients are coming for a refill prescription. It's a medicine they are familiar with, and you bring a different brand. So that helps if you verify with the patient. Is this what you usually take, especially for refill? It's a good check. Yes. I think to be able to develop pharmacovigilance further in Kenya, we have some fairly good political will, but I think we also need the public itself to embrace the practice and look at it as a service, or out to just make healthcare safe, and not think of it, I would say, like reporting, that it's out to just look out for the bad things. That pharmacovigilance is out to build trust, that people now feel they can come out and talk, and for industry to look at it, that when patients complain about a product, maybe if it is theirs, it is not looking at it in a negative way, but it's for quality improvement, for continuous improvement. So I would like, going forward, to just have the public and industry embrace pharmacovigilance, so that going forward, we know that whatever is out there is safe.